we are aware that that's a left for national decision makers. I don't want to speak on behalf of the Right Honourable Prime Minister there, but at regional level, we can see that they are a positive trend.
Okay, I'm going to let you get away with that. Okay, I'm going to start over on the far end and try to...
Please, to the panel, particularly to the Commissioner for AU. We have a lot of regional institutions, ECOWAS, East African Community, COMESA, SADC, and then AU. My question is, there's a talk about political will to get things done. Other than the civil society that holds their governments accountable, are there any compliance issues at these organizational levels, whether it is NEPAD, whether it's CADEP, whether it is AU, and so on? We know of the European Union. I'm not advocating that we should be the European Union, but there are some non-negotiables that members of the European Union must adhere to. Do we have that?
I note you are talking from either the perspective of the non-state actors, but just general on compliance. Well, I think the African Union has moved a long way in ensuring that there is compliance. You look at, for example, the number of countries, Madagascar, Mauritania, Niger, which have really kind of did wrong as far as the constitution is concerned. The African Union heads of state and government have got a regulation which ensures that if you do not do what you are supposed to do as a country, as a leader, then you are no longer a member. But then at the same time, we try to use what we call like proactive action. We negotiate with them and ensure that they come back to book. Madagascar has been a problem, but when you look at Guinea now, elections took place. Mauritania, they did the same. They are also along the way. The Niger. So we try as much as possible as it is concerned. But there are a number of areas where compliance, which we are not yet up to, we are supposed to be like EU. The EU Commission, they have 27 members. For us, we have 53 members. To get 53 members agree and then follow through is not all that easy. But I think we are doing it gradually so that we are able to get everybody on board. But it's not as easy as it is. The EU, the development stages is different from the development stage in Africa, as you can see. We have more. We have many wars in Africa. We are, the issue of peace and security is a priority. And then getting compliance from each member state is not easy. We are looking at market integration. We are looking at SPS issues. We are looking at how do we get, they say, for example, the fertilizer. There are many issues Africa is grappling with. While the EU is looking at issues like only on climate change and trade and terrorism, for us, terrorism now is on the increase, and we are trying as hard as possible, you know, what we are doing in Somalia. So these are the kinds of issues which I can maybe not manage to go through all of them, but we are doing our level best. Thank you.
Okay, if I could go to the lady at the...
Can you help us to advocate to change the curricula of our educational system from the rote system to the discovery system, so that we can develop innovations at the scientific level as well as the cultural level? Thank you.
We do need to address it, although I appreciate that, you know, an education minister perhaps would be the most appropriate person to address that. But perhaps the issue here is how one may be able to encourage the incorporation of that into the curricula. And perhaps, Minister from Mali, you'd like to address that.
Merci. Bon, je ne prétends pas répondre à cette question, mais je sais que Madame a raison, le système éducatif en Afrique commence à ne pas bien marcher. Mais je pense que dans le cadre des innovations, nous avons en Afrique beaucoup de ressources humaines de qualité. Aujourd'hui, il s'agit pour les pays africains de croire en leurs capacités. C'est-à-dire, aujourd'hui, quand vous avez votre enfant qui a le bac, tout de suite vous dites, bon, il faut que je l'envoie dans une université aux États-Unis ou en France ou en Angleterre. On ne croit pas en ce que nous faisons nous-mêmes. Je crois que nous ne pouvons pas payer tout le temps de l'argent pour faire étudier les enfants à l'extérieur, les enfants africains. Je disais hier que ce dont les autres hommes sont capables, les Africains sont capables, je pense qu'il faut qu'on repense la façon de l'éducation en Afrique. Et là, je pense que les ministres de l'éducation sont mieux placés pour ça, mais pour ce qui me concerne, je pense très sincèrement, nous avons tous étudié, bon, moi, personnellement, je n'ai pas étudié à l'extérieur. J'ai étudié dans une école polytechnique de mon pays. Et je n'ai pas outre mesure de complexe vis-à-vis des autres Maliens qui ont été formés ailleurs et qui sont revenus. Et je crois que pour l'Afrique, il faut croire en ce que nous faisons. Et ce qui se pose aujourd'hui en termes d'éducation en Afrique, c'est que je crois, c'est que nous avons un enseignement de masse. C'est-à-dire que nous avons des écoles pléthoriques, des effectifs pléthoriques, et finalement l'enseignement se dégrade. Mais c'est ici en Afrique que nous devrons trouver, de mon point de vue, la solution. Madame, si je peux continuer sur la question des femmes pour le Mali, parce que vous ne m'avez pas donné la parole. Et je pense que pour le Mali, les femmes également, c'est aussi un autre enjeu. Et je pense que les femmes là, on n'est pas à 50% ou 40% comme le Burundi et le Rwanda, mais nous avons 7 femmes dans le gouvernement, nous avons 12% au Parlement, nous avons une femme présidente de la Cour suprême, une femme médiateur de la République. Donc je pense que le débat des femmes en Afrique, c'est un débat réel. Et pour ce qui est de l'agriculture, il y a un texte qui dit tous les aménagements que l'État fait, les femmes ont droit à 10%. Et les femmes au Mali ont accès à la terre, les femmes peuvent avoir des titres fonciers, peuvent avoir des coopératives agricoles et détenir des titres fonciers. Et je crois que c'est en ce moment, au Mali, où nous n'avons pas ces problèmes-là. Merci bien.
Did you say women should have access to 10%? Is that what you said? They have access to 10%. Okay. Okay, 10%.
Absolument. C'est-à-dire, si les aménagements que l'État fait, si l'État aménage 100 000 hectares, 10% c'est pour les femmes.
Okay.
Voilà.
Understood to us and work to implement them so we can have progress by the time we meet again next year. Thank you very much, and thanks to you as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much to Dumi, and thank you to the honorable ministers for sharing their time and policies. As the ministers make their way down, can we please usher them with a round of applause? Thank you very much. Please allow me, without further ado, to bring onto the stage the forum founding and partner organization leader.
His Excellency Mr. Kofi Annan, that is a call to action on concreteness, and this is what the African leaders are looking for. They are tired of continuous engagements without actually defining concrete interventions on the ground, and would like to work with all partners, international partners, African partners, civil society organizations, the private sector, because we believe that collectively we can make an impact in addressing the challenges of poverty and hunger in Africa. I thank you.
Thank you very much to the forum founding and partner organization leaders for those words. Thank you, gentlemen. Here's a quick reminder also to please make sure that you have your parallel session summary, which is at the front desk, and there is also